In today's video, we are going to review the Allen's Cognitive Scale, also referred to as the ACL scale. Plus, as always, I'll show you how I personally simplify and memorize this content. Welcome to the OT Minute. My name's Arno. I'm a third year OT student. Let's get right into our topic today. Allen's Cognitive Levels is a well-known scale that aims to objectively score a person's functional cognitive abilities. It specifically looks at motor tasks and behaviors to help determine cognition. It's used in a variety of settings where cognition is assessed and is often used with psychiatric, acquired brain injury, and dementia populations. It's also associated with the ACLS-5 assessment. I've linked their website and a couple other helpful resources down in the description, so be sure to check that out. The ACL uses a 6-point scale, one being the lowest and six being the highest cognitive functioning. Each of the six levels is further subdivided into 5 modes that provide a more detailed analysis of a person's cognition. For example, in the first level, there's 1.0, 1.2, 1.4, 1.6, and 1.8, and the same for level 2 and so forth. I won't go over all of the modes in this video, but I'll go over some important ones that I think help us remember the different levels and also helps us when we start to think about function and occupational therapy and what we can do possibly for intervention. All right, that brings us to our first level here, which is the automatic actions level. A person in this level is extremely cognitively disabled and can really only do automatic motor and nervous system responses. At this level, a person is pretty much one step away from a complete coma. Let's pull up a visual that highlights some of the key things in this level. The keyword that I associate with this level is reflexive. At 1.0, the person may pull their hand away from a painful prick or a pinch or grimace their face when exposed to bright light. They really aren't moving much. As they progress through level 1, they may begin to shift their head to follow someone walking in their room or a large object like a bunch of balloons in the hospital room. At 1.6, a person can roll in bed, and at 1.8, they can raise a body part when asked. That's the little hand that's up here. At this level, a person is totally dependent and cannot complete any task by themselves. All ADLs will require total assistance. The second level is the postural actions level. The title tells us a lot. The level focuses on gross motor and postural movements for the most part. Therefore, I associate the words gross motor and posture with this level. Let me share my screen and we'll talk a little bit more detail. At level 2, a person may begin to make bigger changes in their position if they're uncomfortable, including sitting up and standing. As you can see here, at a 2.0, a person may be able to sit up in bed. As I progress, their writing reactions begin to return, meaning you will see their head writing if their weight is being shifted or they're shifting their weight. At a 2.4, they can be found wandering aimlessly, potentially. That's why I have a little alarm here on the right side, because at this stage, safety would be a huge concern for me. Supervision and physical assistance is super important for safety at this level. At the higher mode of 2.8, they may begin being able to assist with simple things like pushing off the bed with their hands to get out of bed when cued, or they may hold onto a bar for supporting themselves. These are still mostly gross motor postural movements with no refinement outside of what is almost reflexive. At this point, a person may be considered max assist since they can begin to assist in very limited ways, but the therapist by far will still be doing the most work during things like ADLs. I want to take a quick second here and just stop and talk about a quick study tip that I think will make the memorization process of the ACL scale a lot easier. If you're trying to memorize this scale, you really want to pay attention as we move into talking about level 3 and 4. If you understand the difference between level 3 and 4, which is kind of the mid-range of this model, you can split the scale in your mind and use common sense to figure out the other levels. For example, we already know if someone is a level 1, which is pretty much one step away from a coma, they're going to be laid up in bed. And spoiler alert, if someone's in level 6, they're going to be a person without any deficits. So knowing level 3 and 4 will make it easy to deduce if somebody's in level 2 or 5, because you know if the person or the case you're working with isn't laid up in bed and they're not completely functioning, but they're not 3 and 4, you know it's going to be either level 2 or 5. So hope that helps a little bit. This leads us to the OT question of the day. I'd love to hear from you. What's your favorite memorization strategy or technique for memorizing and remembering scales such as the Allen Cognitive Levels? Post your answer down in the comments section and let me know. All right, back to the levels. The third level is the manual actions level. Think simple 1 or 2 step incomplete tasks for this level, including basic familiar fine motor movements. Let's look at a couple of notable modes to give us a better idea what a person is able to do as they progress in this level. At level 3, a person can grasp using their hands to grasp things, and as they progress, they will be able to manipulate objects and use them more appropriately. For example, at a 3.0, they may be able to grab a toothbrush or some type of object. At a 3.2, they may actually be able to distinguish it from, you know, if it's a toothbrush, they may be able to distinguish it from a comb. By 3.8, a person should be able to use most common everyday items in very simple ways and distinguish between them. At this point, they may require moderate assistance for ADLs. Now, fourth, we have the goal-directed actions level. This one has a few very notable modes that I want to go over. Now, the words that I associate with this stage is familiar and complete, and I'll show you why. All right, let's look at level four, which is goal-directed actions. The words that I associate with this level is familiar and complete. At a 4.0, a person can sequence steps. At this stage, a person will be able to not only pick up a toothbrush and do a brushing motion, they may actually be able to complete a series of steps correctly. For example, they may be able to pick up the toothbrush, apply toothpaste, and bring it to their mouth. At a 4.4, a person may be able to complete an entire activity by themselves with some cueing. Here, the visual is supposed to progress from sequencing steps 1 through 3 to actually completing the whole task. That is a huge functional marker to keep in mind. Again, these are familiar tasks. They're not novel or new things or complicated. As a person progresses to a 4.6, they may be able to go home. They will still need at least minimal assistance and should be checked on throughout the day for their safety. Of course, you would want to use your own clinical reasoning to determine if social supports and other factors of the client is sufficient for making a determination for going home, and that's usually done within a team. These assistance levels are only rough guides. Since going home is such a big deal for a client, I highlighted it and I think it's worth memorizing. As you progress to a 4.8, a person may begin showing some early signs of new learning through lots of repetition. Therefore, you see the head here with gears on repeat. It's also important to note that at this level, the person is not able to problem solve unexpected issues or errors that arise during their functional performance. Their inability to adapt and problem solve issues still leave them needing support. And generally at this level, individuals need minimal assistance. Level five is called the exploratory actions level. I'll pull up my screen again and let's take a look. A person in this level will be able to begin comparing, adapting, changing their actions in addition to achieving new learning without rote repetition. The puzzle pieces here represent the ability of someone at a 5.0 to compare variations of actions and objects. I use the imagery of a puzzle because a person building a puzzle would need to be able to notice the differences between each piece and recognize when what they're doing with the piece is not working. And therefore, they would maybe change either the piece that they're using or the way they're trying to fit them together. This person with his head in a book represents that at 5.4, a person kind of progresses to self-directed learning. So there's just higher levels of new learning happening here. At a 5.8, a person would be able to consult with others in order to problem solve or learn new things and again, continue to adapt better to their environments or occupations. And in general, the level of assistance would be a standby assistance. Now, as we move on to level 6 of Allen's cognitive levels, we'll see that problem solving starts to be more efficient and effective. Level 6 is called the planned actions level. At this point, a person can do abstract and complex thinking and doing. They're going to be completely independent. There's not much to say about this. This would be a great goal for everybody. Not all clients will reach this level, but again, it's where somebody's typical functioning. All right, let's take all of this visual and auditory information and consolidate it into a quick and easy visual. That'll make it easy to remember the different levels and hopefully apply it when you need to. All right, let's sum Allen's 6 cognitive levels up in this simple and easy visual. I have our 6 levels here listed and we'll go column by column and talk about what each one of these are. And again, I do want to note that there is technically a level 0, which just means that that person is in a coma. But again, the main 6 levels that we're going to be talking about are these. And so for the first level we talked about, it's really a level where that person is bedbound. They're not getting up on their own or anything like that. Everything's kind of reflexive. And then level 2, you may see somebody actually get out of bed, maybe do more postural or writing reactions, they might stand, they may really do just gross motor, really basic type things like holding on to something while standing. And then level 3 is when they're able to do manual actions where they're able to to grab a toothbrush and bring it to their mouth. Really simple things. And then level four is when they're going to be able to actually, for the first time, be able to complete a task from start to finish. At 4.6, they may be able to go home with assistance and people checking in on them. And then in level five, you're going to see somebody be able to do more complex cognitive things like problem solving and doing new learning. And then they're 100% at level six. Not much to say about that. This column is the assistance levels, and it's pretty straightforward. Total assistance, max assistance, moderate assistance, min assist, standby assist or supervision, and independent. Here I've got the different time levels for attention. At level one, they're not going to have pretty much any attention. Level two, they may have a couple minutes. Level three, they're going to be about 30 minutes or less attention. And then level four, it's going to be roughly about an hour or less attention span. Think about it practically. If somebody has limited attention, is new learning going to happen? Probably not. When a person achieves better attention, that's when new learning is going to start to happen. Finally, we have our mnemonic here, which is Alan provides me glorious eval potential, which is 100% true, and the reason why this scale is awesome and helpful for us in occupational therapy. A stands for automatic, B stands for postural, M stands for manual, G stands for goal-directed, E stands for exploratory, and P stands for planned actions. Hopefully this helps you remember the different levels of the scale. Thank you so much for joining me on the OT Minute today. I hope this video was helpful regarding the Allen cognitive levels. Don't leave without subscribing. We'd love to have you join the OT Minute community, and we'll see you in the next video.